It's the third stop on the Viessmann FIBT Women's Bobsleigh World Cup. Whistler in British Columbia, the westernmost province of Canada. We are close to the Pacific Ocean, but up in the mountains, the water is white. It has frozen and snowed heavily overnight here. Olympic Plaza down in the center of the village, which is bustling as the ski season is just about to explode into action as the snow arrives. And on the Whistler sliding venue, it is the second and deciding heat of the Women's World Cup round number three. I'm Martin Haven. Sitting alongside me is Canadian legend. There you are. Got her to giggle before she even got to say a word. Helen Upperton. Helen, it wasn't snowing at the end of the first run. It was raining and nastily raining, but it now seems to be dry as we get ready for the second runs.
Yeah, you can see on the replays from the first heat the amount of precipitation falling. It actually apparently was snowing at the top and raining at the bottom of the bobsleigh track, so welcome to Canada and its crazy weather.
Well, better for it to snow on the athletes and rain on the TV announcers than the other way around. Well, you saw Fabian Meyer of Switzerland, great run from the former junior world champion to lie in third place. Two very impressive and very experienced drivers in front of her, Kathleen Martini in the green of Saxony, her home region of Germany, in second place. But it's a Canadian that leads this race. She leads by a substantial margin.
Yeah, huge margin. In the world of the sliding sports, measured in hundreds of a second, 0.4 is a very big and comfortable lead that Kaylee has. Recognizable leg, lots of tattoos. Great push from a rookie brakeman through all that snow.
Well, 6 weeks after Chelsea Valois applied to the Canadian Federation to see whether there'd be some room at tryouts, she ended up in a sled racing with Kaylee Humphreys. So she has certainly earned herself a place on the back of the Canada Watt sled. And they produced a good solid start, and that's all that Kaylee needs. She kicked the door open and rampaged to a lead of 0.3 of a second in the first heat and change. So it's going to be hard to see how anybody is going to catch her. But of course, they will all be trying.
And it's going to be an interesting fight for the other two medal positions, I think, with a really close race from second to fourth. And it'll be fun to see, actually, because earlier today in the men's race, we saw Steve Holcomb with his third consecutive win of the season, and Kaylee is in a position to do the same thing.
Absolutely right. Alexander Zubkov might do that tomorrow in the four-man as well. You just saw the four runners going down the track. Air temperature hovering just above freezing now that the rain has stopped. Ice -1, -2. And that running surface should be nice and firm and predictable. We've got 16 sleds going in our second heat. All 16 women's sleds completed the first heat. A couple of little wobbles, but no major dramas. And Russia 3, Russia 2 will kick off the action. They go in reverse order of their first heat performance. So the leader, that's Kaylee Humphreys of Canada, will go last. And, you know, that's a position that she's quite happy with, that she's had numerous times. I mean, you've done the same thing, starting early, kind of a long wait before you get to the crunch at the end of the heat.
Yeah, it gives you a chance to rest. They usually take power naps in the start house where it's nice and warm and get ready for a warm-up in the second run.
You saw the coach Malcolm Lloyd and the crew of Russia 3 disrobing. So let's get this second heat underway then. 16 down to 1. Ekaterina Kostromina of Russia with Natalia Kalashnik in the back of the sled. Kostromina just 25 years old. 340 kilos all up weight. But not as much of that as the crew, so it's still a fairly heavy sled for these girls to be pushing.
Yeah, minimum weight for a two-man bobsleigh in both the men and women's field is 170 kilos, so it's a lot of weight to move as quickly as possible over 50 meters where the start grooves end, and both athletes need to be sitting still and stable in the sled.
Kostromina, just 5'5", 60 kilos, 142 pounds. That's not a lot of beef. Imagine what a big male athlete would weigh getting on for twice that. Women, of course, you want to weigh your sled up as heavily as possible because it then accelerates faster the heavier the mass, and so you end up pushing quite a heavy sled if you've got a line crew. The starting handle is gradually coming in.
Yeah, she had a little problem with her push handle, the pilot push handle at the start there. It looked like it didn't fall into its little resting spot very quickly, so no major issues. Not a very fast start time, though. It could be because they're pushing such a heavy sled due to the body weight of the brakeman. Like you mentioned, they want to get as close as they can, 340 kilos. Oversteer in the entry of 7. You saw her point the nose down, creating a wave and a skid into corner 9.
Yes, a couple of heart-in-the-mouth moments in the first heat, and we're only sitting watching. It must be a little bit nervy times for her as well. She knows she didn't get a comfortable first trip. This is tidying up a little better, though.
It's a better run than the first run. She's probably got a little bit more confidence after that first heat today. 136.3 kilometers an hour. Just to put it into perspective, in the first run, our fastest women's sleds were all over 140 kilometers an hour in that bottom speed trap.
That is top speed, 136. That is so close to 85 miles an hour that you wouldn't be worrying about the 0.2 mile an hour difference. That's quite quick down at the bottom of the track. And those fans down on the finish, and particularly further down towards Thunderbird, the last corner, really feel the speed.
Yeah, you see this huge drop out from a way too high of a line at the exit. She's going to hit that right wall. She heads down the bend away. We call it a bend away because actually that is a corner 8 in that straightaway. The straightaway curves slightly to the right. It's very difficult to shoot through that without hitting the wall. And you can see a huge skid as she goes into corner 9. But definitely a better run than her first heat.
Trapped a finger in the release lever there. Somebody can see her. She's got blood on the end of it. Anastasia Tambov-Saver next up. More experienced than her young teammate, now 30 years old, from Krasnoyarsk, the head of the center of the Russian sliding world.
You can see she has a huge start advantage off of this start. She's over a second ahead of her teammate. A problem in the first corner, hit on the right wall. Anastasia was a luge athlete before a bobsledder, so she's got a pretty good handle on how to steer and drive pressure corners.
Russian driver, of course, Alexander Zubkov was a loser as well before he was snaffled away by the bobsled crew.
She's increasing her lead here up to 1.34 seconds. Let's see a big wave in a two-pressure corner 11 heading into the bottom of the track, 125.8 kilometers an hour.
Miles an hour down at the bottom, 138 at 86 and a half miles an hour. Speed's picking up.
Also a much better run for this Russia 2 pilot, cleaning up a lot of mistakes, especially in the top part of the track.
55.63 slide, 56.02 on the first run, so she's tidied it up by, well, 0.4, but quite possibly getting on for half a second, depending on whether the track is actually as quick as it was in the first heat. And that's, again, you know, experience. 6 runs down in training, the 7th and now the 8th, of course, you're going to get a little better, you hope.
Yeah, you see this exit here of corner 1, hit on the right wall, but she recovers pretty well. You can see her try to straighten the sled out, get a good entry into 2. Much better than the first run. You have to try to be clean in the top portion of the track. It's where you build all your velocity. You want to stay off the walls. You want to try to prevent any skidding. It's very important. All that work you do over 50 meters to push is just negated if you start tapping walls.
Astrid Radjenovic of Australia, born and bred in Sydney, now lives, part of her life in Brisbane, part in Serbia, and with her husband Vuk, and a lot as a gypsy on the road. Fiona Harrison from Yorkshire behind her on the brakes, former pusher and driver for Great Britain, now breaking the Aussie sled.
She appears to have replaced her visor, which flew off in corner 13, the 50-50 on the first heat, because of a very rough transition in the bottom part of the track. Either somebody found it and they put it back on, or she's got a new one.
Well, they started 5:41 in the first heat, 5:32 in the second heat. So definitely up for this, but a couple of skids early on.
Yeah, skid again there from 5 to 6.
Trying to raise money back home to get a slightly newer sled. You can hear it quite rattly. She said the back axle's a bit bent as well, which doesn't help.
No, it doesn't. Let's see if she can clean up this bottom portion of the track. The first run was a little bit rough through here. This looks much smoother, way smoother, 125.2 kilometers an hour. You want to see close to 140, and she is. Much better run from the Australian pilot, 0.4 of a second back.
55.74 first heat, 55.47 second heat.
I think also the difference in the start time is coming from the fact that the snow is no longer really falling. It was coming down quite heavy during portions of the first run, so they have a little bit of a cleaner track.
Well, you can see from a race suit that the sled is hardly dry inside, and that has filled up with slush and ice. And the girls look pretty happy with that. It was a much more comfortable ride, definitely.
Yeah, you see a little bit of a skid here. She slid off the corner there, heading from 6 into 7. Yeah, she lost her back end. Hence the name of this corner, Looter's Loop. They call it that because there can be some very interesting lines on this track. If you lose pressure in the sled in those big two pressure corners here in Whistler, the back end falls away. We've seen a couple pretty interesting lines in both the two-man race and the women's race today.
So Australia in the leader's box, Russia second and third. And Russia number one now just about to take the ice.
Another one of our summer Olympians here on the pilot push bar, 4x100 meter silver medalist from Russia.
5:30 start, 5:35 in the first heat, so just a fraction quicker than the Aussies. They had 0.2 of a second in hand over Australia from the first heat. Not much of that alive now.
1600s in the lead. Again, the lack of experience from all these pilots, like you said, the more runs they're taking, the smoother they're getting down the track.
This has now opened up the margin from 1600s to 3600s. Looked a little like she was hanging on to the corner there and a bit wavy.
Yeah, big wave in corner 11. Nice lines in the bottom of the track, though, 124.7. I think Olga's probably the pilot with the most promise heading into Sochi. She had a great Athens Olympics as a summer Olympic. She's a great push athlete, and it's very important in the sport of bobsleigh to have a fast start. So,
okay.
I'll tell you what, Astrid Radjanovic just came down in 55.47 in an antique sled with the bent back axle. Russia 1 came down in 55.47 in a relatively new Singer sled that's been well serviced. So, yeah, if Astrid can get her kit a little bit quicker, then you can see that she will move up the order. But the flip side of that coin is, what about the Russians?
Yeah, they are having a little bit of trouble. And Whistler's the type of track that will highlight, you know, not a lot of run experience, not a lot of run volume. You see pressure building at the exit of corner 9 here. This is where the speed starts to pick up. Inexperienced pilots start to fall behind a little bit. Gets very fast down there. Our top women's pilots are over 140 kilometers an hour at the bottom.
It is Russia that leads as Canada 2 comes to the ice. Great result, top 6 finish in the men's race for Canada 2. What about Canada 2 here? Jen Cacchetti and Kate O'Brien. Jennifer in her first full World Cup season.
5:27 push time, 500s in the lead over the Russian sled.
She was only 200s in front after the first heat. She's a great athlete, ex-brake woman. She won the world championship with Kelly Humphreys in Lake Placid in February. But starting in the front seat for the full season, that's a big learning curve for her.
Already, though, this is a much better run than her first heat. The sled is straight in the straightaway. She has much smoother control of the sled. 500s, a bit of a skid there going into corner 9, but 500s still in the lead.
Just the commentator, it wasn't me, it was Helen.
Still holding on to that margin, 125.5. Rough exit of the 50-50.
Top speed, though, so far.
137.4. This isn't the fastest speed we've seen. 900s of a second.
Just behind. Oh, Graham Richardson disappointed with that.
She had a much better top portion of the track, a little bumpy in the bottom, and that's why when she came around that finish curve and the bottom velocity wasn't the same as the Russian, she fell back that uphill section. There's only a few pilots left on the circuit that wear goggles to compete. Most of the drivers use visors. It seems to be a tradition in the Canadian program because of Pierre Luters.
Well, the one thing that goggles have is that they're very unlikely to steam up.
Look at this late entry into corner 13, the 50-50. The runners are turned. The pressure's pushing the sled up the corner. You can see the articulation coming down, trying to keep the sled on all four runners. She will not be happy with that bottom part of the track.
Happier than if she hadn't hauled it off. You know, that's almost where instinct takes over what you're trying to do and just rescues you. Next up, USA 3. Jamie Grubel in 11th place after the first heat, just 300s from a top 10 spot, with Emily Azevedo on the back handles.
Great shot of the steering ropes, the D-rings, as the pilot and brakeman push off the block. 5:24 start time, good start time.
Yeah, big improvement. They had a 5:32 first hit, and that was seventh quickest in the field. This is taking them down to top three or four starters.
I think a lot of this has to do with the snow that we saw in the first heat. All three of the American pilots struggled a little bit in the first run. This is their first time on the Whistler track in 6 runs of training, so this is their seventh and eighth run down this very technical and very fast track. Skid at the end of the straightaway into corner nine. Seems to have a bit of a better run going 600. She's losing time to the leader, and 124.9 is not fast enough. Out of corner 11, she should still be dropping time to our leaders. Or not.
139. Well, the Bodine sled certainly cleaves the air very efficiently. That's one of the things that Jeffrey Bodine wanted when he started the program, was for the U.S. athletes in bobsled to have good kit, and it is still among the fastest. And that... she managed to get the good lines when the speeds were at their highest.
Yeah, at the bottom of the track.
We so often say you can lose a race in the first two or three corners by making mistakes and giving away a lot of your speed, but she found some to save herself.
Yeah, she didn't have a great speed velocity out of corner 11, but nice. You can see much more control at the exit of 13. She's not oversteering. Their runners are pointing pretty straight. Very good bottom velocity. She's been the closest to 140 kilometers out of any of the women coming down the track so far in the second run.
So Jamie Grubel leads. She looked like she had confidence that she was coming off 50-50 and wasn't going for the panic steer. What will happen now? We have three American sleds in a row, 11th, 10th and 9th. And because of the threat of weather, there is no commercial break outside the top 10. So it's the hurry-up offense. There's Emily Azevedo on the left, Jamie Grubel on the right-hand side. They are our leaders for the USA. 10 sleds left to go in this third women's bobsleigh World Cup race of the season. And this is Jasmine Fenlater in USA 1.
5:28, first heat push time. We'll see if they can improve on that. A bit of a tough time getting into the sled. It looks like she slipped, got stuck, managed to get in though. 5:20, improvement on the start time by 0.08 seconds despite the mistake on the load.
Again, that is indication that they are going down a clear start area and not a snowy one.
Bit of a tough exit out of corner three with a hit before four. Trying to better their teammates at the bottom of the track. Jasmine had an amazing start to the season with a medal in Lake Placid on her home track. Rough entry into corner nine, but building on her lead with 1700s in the advantage over her teammates. Up to 0.2. 125.1, not bad speed.
See what she's got the bottom. 138.1, not quite as quick. Is she going to be in front? 1600s to 1700s. She just keeps her nose there.
55.34 downtime, so a couple hundreds faster than her first heat.
Jasmine Fenlater, Katie Ebeling, the crew of USA 1. And these numbers are not fixed. They will change around as their performances change during the season. In fact, we'll probably see quite a few crew member changes as well. Great start, though.
Yeah, we're seeing a replay of this slip she had getting into the sled. She doesn't get her feet over the cowling. She clips her knee. You can see her struggling, all the weight on that push bar. If she wouldn't have had that much weight getting over the cowling into the sled, she could have fallen off the sled. I can't imagine that thought of being a brakeman in the back of a sled with no driver.
Yikes. Now, that I have never seen. Not sure any brakeman wants to be in that position. We have to try and climb over the front seat. Alana Myers and Lolo Jones, USA 2, 9th after the first heat.
Fastest pushing sled on the first one with a 5:16 start time.
Alana, originally from Douglasville, Georgia, now works at Order.
64.5 kilometers an hour. That's a pretty good start velocity. They should 0.2 in the green on the advantage of their two American teammates that are waiting at the bottom.
Season great podium result. 5-11 getaway.
Huge wave in corner seven. She must have oversteered the first pressure, dropped into the area of the corner with no pressure. That's a little bit of a scary exit. She's caught back up again. 1200. She's lost some time. 123.2 is not a fast velocity out of corner 11. You're going to see her still lose some time here. Down to 300s. She's going to be behind her teammate at the bottom.
And she is as well, 55.50. It's USA 1 from USA 2 from USA 3.
That's disappointing. It's all because of corner 7. She actually, it didn't pop up on the screen, but they pushed a 5.11, which tied the start record set at the Olympic Games by Kaylee Humphries and Heather Moyes. That's an incredible start time and a bit of a rough run, especially through corner 7. You see the sled here climbing at the exit of 7. Way too high. It's basically like falling out of a two-story building here as they come and hit the short wall on the right-hand side.
A great start for Lana Myers and Lolo Jones, Summer Olympian, who one of four who have joined the U.S. program over the fall, really, since London 2012, tying the all-time start record here. Well, next up is Paula Walker and Jill Cook. Junior World Champions a couple of seasons ago. That was Jill's rookie season. And in the TV truck, we've just been devouring a cake that they made for bribery purposes the other day.
Come on now!
So, lots of talents in life. I started 5.36 in the first heat, only 10th quickest start. They've probably got a little bit more in them than that. Let's see what they get here.
We've been seeing all the start times on the second run improve because it's not snowing anymore at the start of the track at 25. Again, a huge improvement, 1,100 improvement over the first run.
Now she could find a lot more by tidying up the drive in a similar manner. First three corners have gone nicely so far.
Yeah, really smooth line so far. Over two tenths of a second in the lead.
Experience here. She was the America's Cup champion in 2011-12 after a number of successful races.
Huge advantage now, except a big skid going into corner 9 and also a jump into corner 7 earlier in the track, the middle portion, but she's still got a big margin of error to be able to stay in the lead here on the second run.
25 kilometers now, 77.7 now to 86.7. miles an hour, tucks ahead under the cowl as they come steaming up the straight into the lead. First sub 55 run that we've had in the second heat. 54.98 would have left her in sixth position after the first heat, and that may well be where she's aiming to end up now.
Yeah, better push, much cleaner top portion of the track, a little bit of trouble through the middle and in the bottom. You're gonna see here, this is the exit of corner 7. Pretty good line, bit of a skid going into corner 9 though, but not enough to cause her to drop behind. You can see all the snow and the ice spraying off the track, off the sled as she skids sideways down the straightaway.
Well, that was Coach Pete Gunn's reaction to that run through the bendaway into turn 9. Well, it's Great Britain that leads as Christina Hengstra of Austria comes to the line with Alexandra Tursi behind her. And Hengstra, another former junior world champion. Paula Walker won in 2011 and Christina Hengstra won 2012's Junior Worlds. Like all Austrian sliding athletes, lives within spitting distance of the track at Eagles, just outside Innsbruck.
They had a 5.44 first heat push time, 14th ranked push time, and a 5.40 this run, so not that big of an improvement. 63.7, that's a kilometer slower than the fastest sleds we've seen at the start velocity. And you can tell that with the, she's already behind 2/10 of a second, and that comes from the start. She has a bit of a slower push, carrying less velocity into the bottom of the track.
Just 600s ahead of GD1 after the first heat, and now 3/10 back.
Catching a bit of extra pressure at the exit of corner 9.
There.
She's falling back. I'm interested to see how many sleds that move ahead of her. This isn't as clean of a run as her first heat. 139.5, not a bad bottom speed, but she can catch up.
55.32, Paula Walker looks delighted with that. as she moves up, guaranteed a top seven finish now. Getting closer and closer. And, you know, everybody's looking at this now, what their national requirements are to be allowed to go to the Olympic Games. It's not that the IOC don't invite you, the International Olympic Committee. Your national governing body of the sport will have minimum standards set before they'll allow you to go.
Yeah, trying to send competitive sleds to represent the country at the Olympic Games.
And top eight, top seven, top six in World Cup races or World Championships are often the kind of figures that they're looking at. So Paula Walker leading for Great Britain. Next up, two of our three German sleds. First, the fastest starters, and then the most experienced. This is Anja Schneider-Heinzer with Stephanie Schneider behind her. Anja, 34 years old, policewoman from Erfurt near Oberhof. Only one German track that we don't slide bobsleigh on.
This team had the second fastest push on the first heat. We should see them move into the teens on this push. Good load from the pilot and the brakeman very quickly in the sled in a 5:19 starts, 100th faster than the first run. A little bit of a high line in corner two, but nice straight straightaways. The skid into four.
A world and Olympic champion as a brakewoman. Well, the second tier of sliding in Europe, the Europa Cup in 08-09 and 09-10. First 2 years of driving.
Losing a bit of time on the way down the track to the British team.
She's gone from 2/10 up to 12/100 behind.
Gaining it back a little bit. Yeah, 124 is a good speed out of corner 11.
Full kilometre slower than the GB sled, though, so she needs more. 138.3 is getting closer, but not close enough. It's uphill to the line. 55.30, top six position guaranteed for Paula Walker of Great Britain.
Great result for the British team. Disappointing probably for Anja Schneider-Heinzer. She's had a lot of podium results as a pilot, obviously a lot as a brakeman as well. She's very experienced in the sport of bobsleigh.
Well, the 55.30 slide. Still Paula Walker, the only one to crack the 54-second margin.
You can see the pressure building at the exit of these corners here. You can see the brakeman's head a little bit to the left, but buried well deep in the sled. That's also a result of the G-forces. We're seeing a speed difference here from Anja Schneider-Heinzer to our fastest sled. Actually, the Australians.
The Australians with the bent axle that want a new sled. You know, it's funny how things feel compared to somehow how they look on screen. Five sleds to go then, and a big jump forward now in terms of velocity in the first heat to Sandra Kyriassis with Berit Viacka making her first World Cup start of the season. She's been, for the last 2 or 3 years, Sandra's number one choice as brakewoman. Getting herself fit enough to start here. And their first getaway, only 10th in the field at 5:36. Probably not going to go a lot faster than that. 5:29, no. So I take all that back immediately.
Sandra Kyriassis is one of the most talented pilots in the field. Obviously, Olympic gold medalist. She was silver on this track at the World Cup last year, and she has 3/10 of the lead to work with.
She's the Michael Schumacher of women's bobsledding. He's had 7 Formula One World Championships. She had 5 straight World Cup titles, Olympic victories, World Championships. She's been the benchmark for so many years.
3/10 of a second, holding her advantage, smooth run, which is what you'd expect from a pilot. She's increased her lead to almost 1/2 a second now.
Top speed, 126.8, may see quicker, but at the moment, that's it, 78.8, 141.5, 88 miles an hour.
141.5 is the fastest bottom velocity we've seen in the women's second heat so far.
Well, that pushes GB out of the leader's box with 4 to go. It is Sandra Kyriassis of Germany who leads. Tantalizingly close to the medals, but not yet in it.
Well, with 2 less experienced pilots coming down now, Fabian Meyer and Esme Campus of the Netherlands, they're going to have to put a pretty good run together to move ahead of Sandra Kyriassis.
Well, the days when she was the fastest starting and dominant force in the start area are gone. The calendar has seen to that. However, again, a day when Sandra is behind you is a big day for any athlete. I'm Martin Haven. Alongside me is Helen Upperton, the Canadian bobsled athlete, and at the top of the track, the first of our 4 final sliders in World Cup number 3 of the women's bobsled competition. Esme Campos with making her first ever World Cup debut. Is Willie Canis, former track cyclist and multiple BMX world champion. So it's a real change of discipline.
5:29, sixth fastest start.
She's got a great opportunity here, Helen. Just 0.03 of a second off a World Cup medal for the first time in her career. 5:28 getaway is quick, and she can spin.
Bit of a late entry into corner four, but 0.08 of a second still in the lead compared to Sandra Kyriacis, who's waiting patiently at the bottom. Esme was the first sled in through the first heat. It's also probably why there wasn't a big change in the start times. The snow hadn't accumulated in the track as much. She's losing time, only 0.03 of a second in the lead, heading into corner 11. Going to be very close at the bottom, 126.7 kilometers an hour.
She was 126.8 at the bottom, she was 141.5. Esme's 1/100 behind and will go 5/6 further back.
0.07 falls behind the Germany one sled. This is a great result for the Dutch team, her best result of the season so far, and a wonderful way for her Brakeman to debut in the sport of bobsleigh.
Well, she'll be disappointed now to drop back behind Kyriacis, and that's a great indicator of exactly what her targets are now. But also, that is one tick in the box of Olympic qualification criteria met for this Dutch crew. So that's a very important step towards Sochi.
Yeah, Esme took the season off last year. The season before, she had her first ever medal, silver. You can see the line here coming down the bottom of the track into Thunderbird. Huge amount of g-force in the entry of Thunderbird there, and great speed at the bottom, 140.2 compared to Sandra Kyriacis, our leader, at 141.5 kilometers an hour.
Well, that's over 88 miles an hour, very quick indeed on the left. Willie Canis, who cycling fans will know very well indeed. Three to go then, so it is Sandra Kyriacis of Germany that leads, and world champion, junior world champion Fabio Maier, the reigning junior world champion, with Elisabeth Graf behind her, trying to take a medal here for Switzerland.
5:32 is their first push time, run one. 0.04 improvement, 0.12 in the lead. Bit of a skid out of one. You can see the pilot correct in the straightaway. Good recovery from Fabian.
2008 junior world champion. I'm getting my junior world champions confused. 31 years old now. She's never going to make it in the big time. This will be a good season to start.
Pretty smooth run so far. Bit of a skid into corner seven. 1600s in the lead. Really nice straightaway. End away. Corner eight into corner nine. Setting up in the bottom part of the track through Shiver into the 50-50 with almost 0.2 in the lead, 127.6, really good speed.
0.2 up on Sandra Kyriacis. Let's just say that again, 1500s, and still with enough speed to take it to the line. She will be in the medal shortly. She vanishes underneath the curling. This is a very big moment for Swiss women's bobsledding. 54.76 slide. Well, we heard her yelling with delight after the first run. She'll be yelling with delight after that one as well. And whatever the time is, 6 a.m. in the Engadine Valley in Switzerland. There may be a few awake yelling with delight at that as well.
Great result for Fabian Maier, and very exciting with the World Championships being in St. Moritz, Switzerland. Home World Championships. They're going to probably be really looking forward to that event in February.
No kidding. Fabian Maier on the podium. Berit Vjaka high-fives them as the Swiss move into the leader's box. Two to go. And I don't think that Fabian is going to expect any crumbs from the table of Kathleen Martini or our race leader, Kaylee Humphreys. They are not in the habit of giving things away.
Not in the habit. However, the start margin will be a little bit different. And there was only a few hundreds to work with between these two sleds in second and third place after the first run. The start time from Kathleen Martini is going to be very crucial. We're talking about 0.01 of a second. First push time is 5:37.
5:36. The Swiss started 5:28. That's 0.1 of a second nearly. That's all of the difference between them, and a lot more eaten up in the start.
Kathleen is a great driver. A couple mistakes in the top of the track. She needs to stop the bleeding of the time. She's 0.1 back. See her clean up this bottom part of the track and start to pick up speed late entry into corner seven.
moment only third behind Fabio Maier and Sander Kyriassis. Fourth now behind Esme Campus of the Netherlands. She really needs speed at the bottom, which she found in the first heat.
126.1 kilometers an hour isn't going to do it for her, unfortunately. This is not typical of Kathleen as a pilot. Good speed at the bottom, but not enough to move ahead.
And she's going to stay behind, and it is only fourth place for her. Fifth fastest run, 55.0. Oh, dear. Well, I told you she wouldn't let anything slip from her grasp, and that has dropped away. Fabian Maier of Switzerland leads with one to go. Sandra Kyriassis, rather, replaces Kathleen Martini in the medals position. She is currently second. So, Esme Campus is third. Kathleen Martini slips to fourth.
Can see some mistakes in the track. Not very typical of a pilot as experienced and talented as Kathleen Martini. What she usually loses at the start, she makes up for in the track. You see the corner pressure in corner 11 here. She has a very late entry, big wave. It's a little frustrated.
Well, do you know what? If you didn't laugh, you'd cry, wouldn't you? You've just got to let these things go. Switzerland lead. It is Canada now looking for gold. And in 2010, she took the Olympic medal here. She won the World Cup race here last year. Kayleigh Humphreys do it again with a different brake woman. Chelsea Valois on the podium, the first race of the season. Chelsea's first ever World Cup race. It was gold. Will it be gold again? 5:16 getaway, another big start.
Yeah, and 400s faster than their first push time. Kayleigh has so much experience on this track. She had a 4-tenth lead going into this run.
That wasn't over Fabian Maier, that was over Kathleen Martini, who's slipped away. So the gap is bigger, 6-tenths and growing.
You can see really smooth, controlled lines from Kayleigh on this track with over half a second lead on the rest of the field.
Well, now she can basically start waving to people on the way down, and as long as she doesn't lose the steering, it'll still be enough to get to the bottom. 127.2, 79.1 miles an hour. She's got everything. She's got the start, she's got the drive, she's got the speeds.
This is Kayleigh Humphreys' fifth World Cup victory in a row, third victory of the season, same as Steve Holcomb earlier today.
Wow. Kayleigh Humphreys, three on a row at the beginning of this season, and she took the last race of last year at Calgary, Canada, won the World Championships, and she has lost two races last year in Canada. And undefeated on this track, Kayleigh Humphreys wins the gold medal for Canada. Oh, what a great drive, what a great start. They had everything in that Canadian sled. They had the speed from the moment they left the blocks to the moment they stepped out of the sled. Well, there is Fabian Maier of Switzerland, and the last Swiss to win a medal in Women's World Cup bobsledding was Françoise Berdet. That has got to be getting on for a decade ago. Just off the top of my head, I couldn't tell you when it was, but Chelsea Valois there with the braids, and Kayleigh Humphreys with the braids and the goggles, your World Cup winners. That's five on the bounce now in World Cup competition, her sixth straight race for Kayleigh Humphreys. And her third this season, the Olympic champion, returns again to form here. And the fireworks will go off overhead, which will make the interviews particularly entertaining towards the end. Well, the weather didn't play a big factor in the race. What did was being able to put two consistent runs together, and that is so often the case. Kayleigh Humphreys with, as ever, a smile on her face and plenty to say about her drive. Helen Upperton has leapt out of the booth like a jackrabbit. She's on her way up to the finish area and get a chance to talk to the athletes at the end of this third race in the Women's Bobsleigh World Cup. Well, from start to finish, Kayleigh Humphreys and Chelsea Valois had the meeting of everybody. It was Alana Myers and Lolo Jones who tied Humphreys' track start record that she set with Heather Moyse in the Olympic Games in February 2010. But Kayleigh Humphreys, with two big starts, second quickest in the field, taking it to the gold medal. another new generation of Canadian sliders clearly already at the track and probably not enjoying the fireworks or the razzmatazz. Kaylee Humphries the winner then, 0.69 of a second. Fabian Meyer, big day for Swiss women's bobsledding in the medals again. And Sandra Kyriassis dug deep to find a bronze ahead of Esme Campos of the Netherlands, Kathleen Martini and Paula Walker finishing in sixth position for Great Britain.
Gentlemen, we invite you to join us tomorrow at 9 a.m. as well for the four-man bobsleigh that will be going off, as well as the men's skeleton, which will be taking place at 3 p.m. here at the Whistler Sliding Center.
Welcome back to Whistler Sliding Centre. We're in beautiful British Columbia at the end of the third Wiesmann Women's Bobsleigh World Cup of the season. Kaylee Humphries with a perfect record so far. Three starts, three wins is our World Cup leader. Sandra Kyriassis with a fifth, a second and a third lies in second place. And Kathleen Martini is third in the World Cup rankings. Just one podium finish for her so far. Jasmine Fenlater lies fourth for the USA, ahead of Christina Hengster of Austria. And Elena Myers in sixth position for the USA. Fabian Meyer of Switzerland, taking the runner-up spot here, lies 10th in the World Cup standings. Well, the next time out, a fortnight from this weekend, will be at Winterberg in Germany, traditionally regarded as one of the more straightforward tracks. But in bobsleigh training for the second tier of sliding this week, the Europa Cup, they've had over 20 crashes. So in any form of ice sliding, nothing can be taken for granted. Well, you can see the media scrum down there at the finishing dock. We're getting ready to hear from our top three crews. And Helen Upperton and John Morgan are down there with them.
Our ceremony for the third Wiesmann World Cup here in Whistler, Rusty Livingston, Astrid Wolf, and Pat Brown, all members of the jury and the organizing committee, handing out the flowers. And we'll go over now to our third place finisher. David Viacker, Sandra Kariassis, bronze medal. And Whistler, you happy?
Yeah. I'm happy. After the first run, we was in fifth, and so now third. It's better than fifth, so we are happy.
Now you get a chance to go back to Germany.
Yeah.
Good luck. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Now over to a great medal for Switzerland.
Yeah.
Boy, did you know you had that good of a second run?
Yes, I have feeling in the second run is, whoa, oh, cool, but I don't know the time.
But obviously you like this track.
Yes, I like. Yes, it's nice.
Your first medal?
Yes, it's my first medal. It's my first race in the World Cup.
What a way to start. Congratulations. Great medal for Switzerland. Congratulations. Now over to Canadian duo who's won three straight events. Who's your friend here, Kelly?
This is my godson, Reese Younger Morley. My old teammate from Vancouver in 2010, Amanda Morley. It's her baby.
Congratulations. Now, how are you doing this? I mean, you have six heats in North America. You won them all. You won by 6,900s today. I mean, you have goals, but did you think you'd be in this position after three events?
I didn't. I wasn't really sure what to expect this year. Chelsea, this being kind of her first three races, we just went into it trying to do the very best that we can, and it's turned out excellent so far, so we're going to keep working on it, and hopefully we can keep the streak alive.
Well, we'll be watching next time you're in Winterberg, Germany. Congratulations.
Well, congratulations indeed, and Amanda Morley's young son there on the podium with Kayleigh Humphries and Chelsea Valois, Fabienne Meyer, and her brand new brake woman. What a great start to a career for Elisabeth Graf on the podium for the first time. Let's hope they can keep that alive as well. Third position, well, you heard Sandra Kariassis, just happy to be there on the podium. Kathleen Martini, John asked her last weekend whether or not she was looking forward to Whistler, and she said, I think you know that answer. I don't like Whistler. And I don't think that today's result has done a lot to change that. Slipped out of the medals positions in the second and deciding heat. So lots of topsy-turvy action through a busy day here at the Whistler Sliding Centre. Three World Cup races in one day. It makes it a long day for the track workers, a long day for the crew in the truck, and especially out on the mountain. So a big thank you to all of them for keeping the pictures and keeping the faith. Kayleigh Humphries wins three on the bounce. Fabienne Meyer of Switzerland, her first World Cup podium. And Sandra Kariassis returns to the medals for the second time this season. She is always going to be a threat. She is far too experienced, far too good not to be taken seriously. Well, the morning kicked off with action in the women's skeleton competition. All three Canadian athletes in the top four after the first heat. Sarah Reid, who won the season opener, having a really strong run. Her teammate Cassie Horesh was the top-placed Canadian in second after the first heat. Her top four were covered just by 14 hundredths of a second, but she slipped behind. Marion Tace, who led after the first run, was the German who found the pace to take the gold medal. Lizzie Yarndle of Great Britain jumped from sixth to third position. Cassie Horesh just off the podium. It was topped by Marion Tace to round out the three-race North American swing. Well, the two-man bobsled competition went from late afternoon into the dusk. Alexander Zubkov again in strong form. But Francesco Friedrich of Germany, really outstanding start to the season this young man is having. And bearing in mind, we're not in Europe. We're in North America, where he knows the tracks less well. Tying with the Russians for the lead of the race. Two sleds remaining. Lyndon Rush won this race last year, rather this spring, from the leader's box. Second in the final heat. He took the lead here with Steve Holcomb and Stephen Langton. Like Kayleigh Humphries in the women's race, Steve Holcomb, the winner of the opening two-man races of the season. Different brakeman on the back, but same result. Holkey taking victory in the Bodine sled. Stephen Langton joining him on the top step of the podium. It wasn't a massive margin, but it was enough. Holcomb finding it in the final couple of corners to pull in front. And then into the women's race. And once more. The combination of Chelsea Bowler on the back handles and the Olympic and world champion driver Katie Humphries was not to be denied. Chelsea only joins the Canadian setup 6 weeks before the start of the season. She does not know what it is like to lose a race yet. Strings are made to be broken, but Kaylee Humphries shows no sign of wanting to end hers. And that is how the day has ended up here, with a great race for Kaylee Humphries to send the Canadian crowd home happy. More action coming up on the Whistler sliding track from the four-man and the skeleton competitions on Saturday. And then 2 weeks before we rejoin the action in Winterberg in Germany. The season is barely underway and already the statisticians are having a fantastic time. On behalf of the whole crew, my thanks to you for joining us. To Helen Upperton, Martin Haven, I'm saying goodbye.